friend, now we will deal with order 22 of the code of civil procedure. The heading of the order 22 is death, marriage and insolvency of party. What is the procedure to be followed by the court and by the party if a person who is a party to the suit dies? What will happen if a plaintiff dies? What will happen if a defendant dies? What will happen if a party in an appeal dies? All these are matters for consideration in order 22. Now, rule 1 of order 22 says, no abatement by party's death if right to sue survives. The death of a plaintiff or defendant shall not cause the suit to abate if the right to sue survives. Therefore, the question is whether the right to sue survives if it is a personal action against the defendant that will not survive after the death of the defendant. Now, if it is a suit for money, suit for regarding property, suit regarding contract, no matter whether the defendant or plaintiff dies, the right to sue survives. In such a case, the action before court can be continued by the legal representative. Legal representative seems to be distinguished from legal heir. Legal heirs are the personal legal heirs of a party, whereas legal representatives are, as defined in the CPC, persons who in law represent the estate of the deceased. So, who are to be pleaded are the legal representatives. Now, what is the procedure if a plaintiff dies? What is the procedure if a defendant dies? What will happen if all the legal representatives are already on the party? Now, for understanding it, we have to consider rules 2, 3 and 4 of Order 22. Rule 2 deals with recording of legal representatives. Now, for example, a suit is filed by A, B, C, D, E, all the 5 plaintiffs. They are the father, mother and children. Let us assume that the father dies. That is the first plaintiff dies. All his legal representatives are on the party array. Therefore, nobody else need be impleaded in the suit. Therefore, what is required is that only recording those persons as the legal representatives of the deceased plaintiff. A mere recording is enough for which an application is to be filed before the court. It is dealt with in Rule 2. Rule 2 says that where there are more plaintiffs or defendants than one, and any of them dies, and where the right to sue survives to the surviving plaintiff or plaintiffs alone, or against the surviving defendant or defendants alone, the court shall cause an entry to that effect to be made on record. And the suit shall proceed at the instance of the surviving plaintiff or plaintiff, or against the surviving defendant or defendant. It applies not only to the plaintiff, but all plaintiffs, but also to the defendant as well. Any one of them dies and the right to sue survives, plus all the legal representatives are already on the party array, then a mere recording of it is enough and those legal representatives can continue or the suit can be continued against them as the case may be. Now, what will happen if the plaintiff dies? Rule 3 deals with it. Rule 3 says, procedure in the case of death of one of several plaintiffs or of the sole plaintiff. Rule 3 deals with a situation where a sole plaintiff dies or one of the plaintiffs dies. And then all the legal representatives are not on the party array. That means some of the legal representatives who are not on the party array are to be brought on record. And that has to be done by the plaintiff at the instance of the plaintiff, legal representatives of the plaintiff. On filing an application, the court will make a record of it and they will be considered as parties to the suit. All the legal representatives should be impleaded, and for that purpose, a time limit is fixed under Article 120 of the Limitation Act. Article 120 says, under the Code of Civil Procedure, to have the legal representative for a deceased plaintiff or appellant or deceased defendant or respondent made a party, period of limitation is 90 days. It starts from the date of death of the plaintiff, appellant or respondent as the case. Now, within that date, an application has to be filed. Rule 3 says that were within the time limited by law, no application is made under subrule 1, then what will happen? The suit shall abate so far as the deceased plaintiff is concerned. Abatement takes place. What is abatement? Thereafter, suppose there is a sole plaintiff. He died. He has got personal legal representative who do not come on record within time, 90 days. The suit will abate. That means the suit will go, suit cannot continue without the junction of the legal representative. Now, Rule 3 says that the application is not filed within time, the suit will abate. Now, Rule 4 deals with a case where the defendant or respondent or one of the defendants or respondents die. It says that where one of the two or more defendants dies and the right to sue does not survive against the surviving defendant or defendant alone. Defendant means, as per the same Order 22, it applies to the respondents in the appeals also. So one or more of the defendants dies and the right to sue does not survive against the surviving defendant or defendant alone, or the sole defendant dies and his legal representatives are all not on the party hearing, then what should be done? The court, on an application made in that behalf, shall cause the legal representative of the deceased defendant to be made a party and shall proceed. And subrule 2 of rule 4 says that any person so made a party may make any defense appropriate to his character as the legal representative of the deceased defendant. So the legal representative cannot take a contention quite different from the contention which could be taken or which has already been taken by the deceased party. Now, for example, if the suit is filed for recovery of possession of a property, that sole defendant died and his legal representatives are brought on record, they have got a personal claim against the plaintiff. That claim cannot be made in the suit which was originally filed against their predecessor in interest, that is the defendant. Now, subrule 3 says, where within the time limited by law, no application is made under subrule 1, the suit shall abate as against the deceased. So if there is a sole defendant and he dies, the suit abates as a whole. Or if there are more defendants than one and not all the legal representatives are not on the party array and only some of them are on the party array, the rest of the legal representatives are not being brought on record, then the suit will abate as regards the person who the suit will abate as against the deceased. Now, there is a theory of substantial representation which I will mention later. Now, the court, wherever things fit, subrule 4 says that the court, wherever things fit, may give an exemption from impleading the legal representatives of the deceased defendant. That arises in either of the two situations, where the defendant has not made his appearance or he has made his appearance but has not put forward any defense. Then in such a case, the court has power to exempt the plaintiff from the necessity of substituting the legal representatives of the deceased defendant. And if the court finds that in spite of that fact, the ingredients being satisfied under subrule 4, the court has discretion to say that the notice should be given to the legal representatives of the deceased defendant. And they may appear, they may take appropriate contentions which are not barred under subrule 2. That is, a defense appropriate to the character as the legal representative. Now, subrule 4, 5 says, where the plaintiff was ignorant about the death of the defendant, then and he does not make the application within 90 days. Here also, under rule 4 also, the application has to be made within 90 days. And if no application is made within 90 days, then the suit will abate as against the deceased defendant. If it is a sole defendant, the suit abates as a whole. Now, sometimes the plaintiff may not be aware of the death of the defendant. The plaintiff is in Kerala, the defendant is in Mumbai or in Calcutta. He dies there. The plaintiff does not know of the death of the deceased defendant. Now, what will happen? 90 days over. Something has to be done. It is not as if he will be debarred, the plaintiff will be debarred from doing something after the period of 90 days. So, if he can prove that he was not aware of the death of the deceased defendant and he did not make the application within 90 days solely because of the ignorance of the death of the defendant, then he may make an application even after the expiry of the period of 90 days. And then if the court is satisfied that there are sufficient reasons for his not applying within time, the court may condone the delay under Section 5 of the Limitation Act. Section 5 of the Limitation Act provides for extension of the period of limitation for filing an appeal or application other than an application under Section under Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. So an application comes belatedly filed which satisfies the requirements of subrule 5 of rule 4, then the court has power to condone the delay even after the expiry of 90 days, even after the expiry of 1 year. Only thing is that there must be sufficient reason for the same. Now, we have seen about the abatement. If within 90 days, that is Article 120, abatement takes place. Now, what will happen if after the abatement is not, nothing is done after the abatement within a particular time? Article 121 provides for the time limit for setting aside the abatement. That is, the period of limitation is 60 days. And if within time the abatement, an application is filed to set aside the abatement, the court has power to set aside the abatement. If even thereafter, that is 90 days plus 60 days, no application is made either under Rule 3 or Rule 4 for doing the needful, then the delay occurs. So suppose a person dies, a defendant dies, 200 days before the date of application. So 90 days is over, 90 days are over, then 60 days for setting aside the abatement, that is also over, and that means 90 plus 60, 150 days are over. Then on the 200th day, an application is made for impleading, setting aside the abatement, and for condonation of delay. The delay occurs there. What is the extent of delay in such cases? Whether it is 200 days or after 90 days, 110 days, or it is 50 days is the question. Now the answer is, delay is 50 days. Delay occurs only after the period for setting aside the abatement is over. That is over only on the expiry of 150 days. So an application is to be filed to condone the delay of 50 days in case the application is filed 200 days after the death of the deceased plaintiff or the defendant, as the case may be. Now, who has to make the application for impleading? If the plaintiff dies, it is the legal representative of the plaintiff who have to make the application. If the defendant dies, the defendant's legal representative need not do anything. It is the duty of the plaintiff to implead the legal representative of the defendant within time as permitted by the provision. Now, Rule 4 says that where there is no legal representative, a procedure is provided. And who should be impleaded in such case, who should be heard, what the court should do, all these things are provided in Rule 4A. Rule 5 provides for determination of the question as to who is the legal representative. In some cases, a dispute may arise as to who is the legal representative. Now, I will give an example. A defendant, sole defendant is there, defendant dies. He has got wife and children. He keeps another lady. And there is a son in that relationship. And the plaintiff makes an application to implead all of them. And as per law, while a relationship of marriage is pending, a subsequent marriage, if the parties are Hindus, if a subsequent marriage at the time when the wife is already living, that is not legal, and therefore the second lady will not get the status of the wife. Sometimes the children, if there is no the conditions of Section 16 and 5 of the Hindu Succession Act are not satisfied, sometimes the children also may not get any share in the properties of the deceased. That is a matter to be considered differently. Who will consider who are the legal representatives of the deceased to be brought on record? It is the court dealing with the application. The court will consider the respective contentions of the party and decide who in law should represent the deceased person. And on the basis of that decision, a record will be made in the court proceeding that so and so will be the legal representative. And they will continue as the parties to suit. And if the same question arises in an appeal, so for example, a suit is filed. Suit is either decreed or dismissed. The defeated party files an appeal. During the pendency of the appeal, one of the parties dies. What will happen? And the application for impleading can be filed before the appellate court. The appellate court has got all the powers which the trial court has. And if a dispute arises before the appellate court, I will give an example. The dispute is regarding property. A head of the family is the party. He has got, say for example, 5 children, wife, widow. And he has preferred one son and bequeathed, made a will in respect of his property, disputed property, to one of his children, son. Only the son will get right going by the will. So, though the personal legal representatives are 5 number, wife and 4 children, then since he has executed a will and the bequest will take place, son alone will get. So, who in law represents is the son. The estate of the deceased is represented by the son who is a legatee under the will. So, even though there are total 5 persons as legal representatives, the legatee who in law represents the estate of the deceased will be impleaded as a legal representative. Sometimes there may be dispute among the children or among the widow and children about the genuineness or otherwise of a will. Some parties may say that the will is fabricated. It is not executed out of free will and volition of the testator, that is the deceased person. And therefore, the will cannot be relied on. Or somebody may say that the signature appearing in the will is not that of the deceased person. What will happen? The court has to decide that question, whether the will is genuine or not. The appellate court has got, as I said, all the powers of the trial court. Therefore, appropriate evidence can be allowed to be adduced before the appellate court as well. But the appellate court may think that let this question be considered by the trial court so that the appellate court need not spare time for that. Send the matter to the trial court with a direction to decide the question as to who is the legal representative. Where a question arises as to whether any person is or is not the legal representative of a deceased plaintiff or deceased defendant, such question shall be determined. The proviso says that where such question arises before the appellate court, the court may, before determining the question, direct any subordinate court to try the question and to return the record together with the evidence, and a decision will be taken on the basis of those records, its findings and reasons. And the parties who are aggrieved by it, there is a provision that arises under Order 41, that is provisions dealing with appeal. When we deal with Order 41, I will again explain it. Now, we have seen abatement, we have seen the period of limitation, we have seen setting aside abatement, we have seen condonation of delay, etc. Rule 9 deals with effect of abatement or dismissal. Please read Rule 9. Then you will, where a suit abates or is dismissed under the order, no fresh suit shall be brought on the same cause of action. That means there is a bar to the filing of another suit on the same cause of action. Then, sub-rule 2 of Rule 9 provides that the plaintiff or the person claiming to be a legal representative of the plaintiff or assignee or receiver in the case of an insolvent plaintiff may apply for an order to set. That is also takes place under Rule 9. Explanation. The provisions of Section Sub-Rule 3 provides that the provisions of Section 5 of the Limitation Act will apply. That means the period of limitation of 90 days or 50 days as the case may be, and plus that is total 150 days that can again be extended, and the delay condoned by exercising the power under Section 5 of the Limitation Act. Explanation to Rule 9 provides that nothing in this rule shall be construed as barring in a later suit a defense based on the fact which constituted the cause of action in the suit which had abated or had been dismissed under this order. So even if the suit abates and no fresh suit can be filed on the same cause of action, that is not a bar for that plaintiff to take the same contention in a defense to a suit filed against him. Now, no abatement by reason of death after hearing. Rule 6 provides. What will happen if the suit is heard? Evidence is over, hearing takes place, arguments are over, and the court reserves the case for judgment. Thereafter, one of the parties dies. What should be done? Even if nothing is done, that is not going to affect the decision of the case. The court can proceed as if the death takes place before the date of closure of hearing. Now the rule says no abatement by reason of death after hearing, notwithstanding anything contained in the foregoing rules, whether the cause of action survives or not, there shall be no abatement by reason of the death of either party between the conclusion of the hearing and the pronouncing of the judgment. But the judgment in such cases be pronounced notwithstanding the death and shall have the same force and effect as if it had been pronounced before the death took place. Then Rule 7 says that suit does not abate by marriage of a female party. Then Rule 8 deals with the plaintiff's insolvency. Rule 9, as I already said, effect of abatement or dismissal. Then what remains is Rule 10, 10A, 11, and 12, which we will deal with in the next episode. Now, please note two or three decisions which will give you a correct picture as to the impleading, abatement, setting aside abatement, condonation of delay, etc., etc. Please note the decision. 2007, 1 KLT, 673. The corresponding citation in KHC, 2007, 1 KHC. KHC means Kerala High Court cases, 574. Name of the case is Shankaran versus Devagiamma. Then another case is, there the facts are slightly complicated, therefore even if you do not read that decision, nothing will happen, but just to see the headnote or so. 2007 4 KLT 641 Jacob versus Vironi. These two cases were decided by me, I think. Now there is another case that is, what will happen if one of the legal representatives is already on the party? Rule 2 deals with when all the legal representatives are already on the party. Then make a record of it. That is enough. That period of limitation of 90 days will not apply. At any time it can be done. Make a record of it and proceed with the suit. Suppose a sole plaintiff or sole defendant, he dies. He has got wife and four children. One son is already on the party array, either as co-plaintiff or as co-defendant. What will happen? Whether abatement takes place and whether it is necessary to make the application within 90 days and the consequence of abatement and all those things take place. The decisions are uniform to the effect that when at least one of the legal representatives is already on the party array, then there is no question of abatement. Please note a decision. 2007 2 KLT, volume 2 KLT, 410. It is reported in ILR also, ILR 2007 to Kerala, short note 11. One of the legal representatives is among the legal representative of the deceased party. One of the legal representatives already on the party array, in his individual capacity or otherwise, no abatement is. Then there is a theory of substantial representation, that is what will happen if some of the legal representatives are already on the party array and they take part in the proceeding. It ends in the decision of the suit. Later it is disclosed that some of the legal representatives were omitted to be included. What will happen? That is the theory of substantial representation. We will deal with it in the next episode along with the other rules. Thank you.